Hi everyone. A lot of you have been submitting YouTube comments, and a lot of you guys have questions on prostate cancer that you would like us to ask Dr. Scholz. And today, we're going to answer those questions. All right, Dr. Scholz, well, today we're going to be answering some more questions from our YouTube comment section. And I believe these are prostate cancer patients and the caregivers leaving these questions, so I'm very excited to be able to answer them with you in person. So the first one we have is, I'm a 41-year-old with a Gleason score of 3+3 on the right side and 3+4 on the left side. Would radiation be a good treatment? I'm really scared about doing an operation, and what are the chances of the cancer coming back?
Sounds like a very low-risk situation. We don't really know how many cores are involved, and we don't know what percentage of grade 4 is present in the grade 7 side of the prostate. But I think the backstory here is people are nervous about giving radiation treatment to younger men because if there are radiation-induced side effects over the period of many decades, new cancers, scarring, would a young individual be better off just doing surgery? And that is sort of the prevailing belief in the medical community that the younger men need to be operated on and the older men can safely have radiation. I don't ascribe to that view personally. I think that the modern forms of brachytherapy, seed implant radiation, which limit the radiation just to the prostate area, they don't have to beam the radiation through the body to hit the prostate, are quite safe for long-term exposure considerations and certainly a lot less toxic than doing a radical prostatectomy. Personally, if I was in that situation with a highly favorable low-grade cancer that if he was a bit older, we might even just put him on active surveillance. We don't know the details of his pathology, but I would strongly consider doing a radioactive seed implant at a center of excellence rather than thinking about doing surgery.
Our next question is, do you have any suggestions on therapy for ductal carcinoma in the prostate?
So ductal carcinoma is a pathologic variant. When we hear about Gleason scores, we're looking at pathologic grading. And it's known that ductal variants of prostate cancer are slightly higher grade than what the Gleason score would indicate. I think a good rule of thumb is that if you're if you use the grade grouping system that came from Epstein, where you go from 1 to 5, the ductal carcinoma designation means that you go up about a half a point. So if you're a 2, you go to a 2.5, or if you're a 3.5, you go up to a 4. And the in the Gleason scoring system, it might work like this. If you had a 3+4, you might call it a 4+3. If you were had a 3+3, you might move it up to a 3+4. So it's a slightly worse indicator. It's not the end of the world. It just suggests that the cancer is a little bit higher grade than what the Gleason score would suggest.
So our next question is, please address which patients should do a PET scan before TULSA-PRO. Unfortunately, my PET scan was positive for seminal vesicle invasion, and I followed with ViewRay, SBRT, ADT, and Zytiga.
Well, the new PET scans, which are we've talked about quite a bit, the PSMA PET scans, are going to change the way that prostate cancer staging is implemented on a routine basis as soon as they're FDA approved, which could be within a year. And who needs a staging scan? I would say anyone who has intermediate risk prostate cancer or higher should be staged. The favorable intermediate risk patients have such a low risk of metastatic disease, it's probably not necessary to have a staging scan. But if you look at standard intermediate risk or unfavorable intermediate risk, what we call basic or high teal, and then on up through high risk and relapse, all those other patients, everyone wants to know if the cancer has metastasized or not. And these new PSMA PET scans are the best way to make that determination. In the meantime, for patients that don't have access to these PSMA PET scans, which are available at certain academic centers on an investigational basis, the standard approach is to do a CAT scan of the abdomen and pelvis or an MRI of the abdomen and pelvis to look for any grossly enlarged lymph nodes, make sure there's no metastatic disease in that fashion, and then to do a bone scan of some sort. The old technetium-99 bone scans are covered by Medicare, but the F18 PET bone scans are even more accurate. So a bone scan and a body scan is considered standard for anyone with at least intermediate risk prostate cancer to make sure that there's not a surprising metastatic lesion present somewhere that would totally change the treatment protocol.
So a patient left a question that says, if prostate cancer is found in one core out of 12, and that one core is 5% or less, would this qualify for as active surveillance for the active surveillance protocol?
Well, it depends on the grade. If it was a Gleason 3 plus 3, absolutely, that's ideal. If it was a Gleason 3 plus 4, and there's not too much 4, then it would also be adequate for active surveillance. And then if it was a higher grade, a very small amount of higher grade disease in someone that's over 80 years old, then that also possibly could qualify for active surveillance.
Can you speak on, you know, when we talk to patients a lot in these situations, they've maybe just been diagnosed and they just got their Gleason, you know, score back. Can you speak to how important it is to get a second opinion on that Gleason score to make sure if they're going to choose a certain treatment protocol like active surveillance, how important the confirmation of that Gleason is?
Well, reading Gleason scores, like many things, is an art, and the doctors that have greater experience and exposure to a larger amount of reads that have a large volume practice are going to be able to grade it more accurately. And unfortunately, some doctors who are reading Gleason scores at small community areas don't do a lot of Gleason grading, and they can make mistakes. As we're talking through these different questions, we can see how critically important the decision-making process is as influenced by the Gleason score. So it's very easy to take the biopsy slides. They're saved for 10 years after someone has a biopsy and send them off to a place like Johns Hopkins. Get a second opinion as to what the Gleason score really is, and then you know you're working from the most accurate information.
Mm. If you do that, are you paying out of pocket, and do you know how much that is?
I'm not sure. I think insurance will cover it sometimes, and probably on other occasions it's necessary to pay for it. I don't think it's more than a couple hundred dollars.
All right, our next question is, I'm always confused why long-term health is not considered for men who are in their 70s and 80s, like those for when it's in their 40s. And they say that, can you explain this deeper? Because it kind of breaks my heart that doctors seem not to fight as hard for an elderly patient as they would a young patient.
Well, of course, I don't know what's in the hearts of various doctors, but we're in the prostate cancer world, we have to be sensitive to the fact that even the worst prostate cancers take 10 to 15 years to kill someone. And also, we have to be aware of the fact that the treatments for prostate cancer can really harm a man's quality of life, make him impotent, incontinent, sometimes create GI problems. So when the risk of the treatment causing bad quality of life issues is greater than the risk of the cancer causing harm, then people start to slow down on the intensity of the type of treatment that's being recommended. At least they should. So it's a difficult balancing act. And of course, no one wants to be cavalier about the fact that a cancer could, if it behaved particularly badly, cause problems in less than 10 years. It's fairly rare with prostate cancer, but it's not impossible. But experts can usually identify those bad cancers early on and take appropriate measures. So I think in general, I don't think the physicians are unconcerned about the longevity of older people, although I'm sure that's possible with some, you know, problems with HMO insurances and whatnot, where people are trying to minimize spending. But there's also a logical reason to not be concerned about a low-grade cancer in a 75-year-old, because we can be very confident that that cancer will never hurt them.
I think the other thing about it, in talking to a lot of family members who are having fathers or, you know, caregivers and things like that, I think it's really important that they realize it's not just the doctor that is fighting for that patient. You have to fight for that patient, and the patient has to fight for themselves. And I know that when I've talked to caregivers, they get very frustrated. And we've seen this in a couple of cases where the doctors are kind of like, well, they're older, it's okay. Well, if you really do your research, you know, you're either going to find you agree with the doctor, or you're going to find that you need to advocate. And so I think that's why the perspective of PCRI is so important, that you are yet, you know, in charge of your own health in that case.
Yeah, it's doctors are certainly not infallible, and sometimes they're terribly mistaken about things. And it's logical that each patient who only has to concentrate on their one case should be become an expert in the very subset type of prostate cancer that they have, and speak on a more level plane with their physicians and their nurses, and busy doctors, busy nurses can overlook things, and patients are the fail-safe. They're the backup plan to make sure that something really foolish isn't done.
Yeah, I really love that perspective because it kind of takes somebody in a hopeless situation or helpless situation who feels like they can't do anything and puts them in a more powerful situation where they feel like they could actually make a move and have that discussion with the medical team. So it's really cool. Thank you so much for watching. If you would like Dr. Scholz and I to cover one of your questions, you can go ahead and leave them in the comment section of this YouTube video or on our other videos, and we can go ahead and pick them up from there. Also, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. The subscribe button's right here on the right. We come up with new prostate cancer videos every week, and visit our website, pcri.org, if you would like more information. We hope you have a great week.